begin straight away. This is a subject on which I've spoken a number of times. So the PowerPoint is not new, it's an old one, but I thought I would just use a few graphs to illustrate the arguments I'll be putting forward. Now, we all know that the rural sector in our country is still stagnating. In fact, if we look at the contribution in terms of the output per head and GDP per head, then the primary sector, which is that that purple line at the bottom, you can see is virtually horizontal. That is, the output per head from the primary sector had hardly risen at all. This ends in 2000. These are three-year averages, so it's ending in 2008, I think, the last figure. The only contributor to GDP growth in this country has been, as is well known, the services sector. That's the line, the tertiary sector, with the little crosses, which is going up fast, and even the secondary sector has hardly risen at all in terms of output per head. If we look at the contribution of the three sectors to GDP, then again you can see that the primary sector has been going down fast. I'm just repeating things which are well known, just to set the background. And by now it contributes hardly 1/6 of GDP, even though it supports more than 60% of the population. So that is a clear indication that the output per head and income per head there has been going down in real terms. India has not been industrializing. The share of the secondary sector in GDP has again hovered around 25-26% all through the period of neoliberal reforms as well. It was rising a little earlier, but after that it has become stagnant. So what is this particular kind of trajectory of growth that we've been experiencing? I have been talking about a specific growth trajectory which does not represent industrialization, but a sort of tertiarization of the economy. And that is a very unbalanced kind of a growth. It means that even though incomes are being generated in the tertiary sector, and the tertiary sector, the services sector itself, is an extremely heterogeneous one. The majority of people in this sector earn very low incomes. But there's a small segment, as you all know, this is the IT-enabled services of various kinds, BPO and so on, where incomes are very high. And this is what has been expanding very fast. But the problem with the services sector growing while the sectors representing material production are virtually stagnant is that, you know, if I am an IT professional, I'm earning a very high income from working at my computers, developing software and so on. Unfortunately, I do not go and buy my clothes in a virtual shop. I do not wear virtual clothing. I do not go to a virtual restaurant online to eat food. So incomes are being generated in a segment which is not contributing directly to material output at all, in a situation where the material productive sectors are stagnating. And that is creating serious problems of imbalance. When material production per head of population is not growing fast enough, but incomes in one segment is growing very fast, then it is just a matter of common sense that those who have the rising purchasing power, and this is a very tiny minority of the population, will be pulling away resources through their ability to command more resources on the market, more commodities on the market. They'll be pulling away more and more commodities and consumables from those who cannot afford to buy because their incomes are not rising fast enough. And that, unfortunately, is precisely the growth trajectory in this country, where a minority is getting rich very fast, and most of us belong to that minority. We have no reason to be dissatisfied with neoliberal reforms. It has given us access to a lifestyle which is even better than that perhaps in New York or in London, because which citizen of the USA or of UK or the European countries has command over cheap services the way a rich Indian does? So, you know, the Indian, the top 5 to 10% of Indians are very happy with neoliberal reforms. And by and large, they are not willing to look at what is happening to the living standards and the basic consumption, whether basic needs are at all being satisfied for the vast majority of the population, not only in rural India, but also in urban India. As a matter of fact, urban poverty in the last 5 years has been rising faster than rural poverty. So this is the overall background. It is not a very, it's a rather disturbing trajectory of growth that we've been following, particularly in the period after 1991. Sorry, I'm going the wrong way. Now, I would like to get to the question of the persistence of agrarian distress. In order to understand that, and the situation of agrarian depression, I distinguish between depression and crisis. A situation of depression in agriculture has been there now for a decade and a half, from the mid-1990s. It's getting on to almost two decades now. Combined with acute distress in specific areas which have been characterized by debt-driven farmer suicides. You all know about that. I don't have to give you the figures of that. Now, what explains this? First of all, what explains the long depression? What explains the crisis in areas growing cash crops? So this is, we have to understand that in order to understand why agrarian distress is still persistent. And farmer suicides have not gone down. Every year, 16 to 17,000 farmers continue to commit suicide. And in practically every state, with a concentration in particular states and areas where there is cash crop for exports, where that is predominant. So I have to go back a little to give you my analysis of the origins of agrarian distress, and that is very clearly tied up with the nature of neoliberal economic policies, the core of which is exactly the opposite of the Nehruvian dirigiste policies which were being followed from independence up to the late 1980s. The Nehruvian policies were essentially, in terms of fiscal policy, expansionary. That is, the state played a major role in undertaking expenditures, both productive expenditures as well as capital formation expenditures and its own expenditures as well. So you had an expansionary fiscal stance. The state, for all its drawbacks and all the problems of the fact that you did not have radical land reform in India, nevertheless, there was one area in which the state did play a positive role, and that is to give priority to food security, which it interpreted to mean that India has to be self-sufficient in food grains. There was an emphasis given to production of the most important staple for the mass of our population. And it still remains the most important thing, food grains. Because if you look at the National Sample Survey data on nutritional intake, as late as 2005, 74% of average calorie intake in rural India came from the cereals alone, even leaving out pulses. And more than 75% of protein intake of the average rural Indian came from cereals alone. The proportions are a bit lower, but they're still very high in urban area. 66% of energy and protein intake just from the cereals alone. So in our country, food security and adequate nutrition means food grain security. Okay? So the Nehruvian strategy, in my view, with all the criticisms that we made of it at that time and all its drawbacks, still had this positive feature that it tried to reverse the colonial experience of falling per capita food grain production. In the 50 years before independence, our food grains output per capita had fallen from 200 kilograms per head. It had reached an all-time low of 136 kilograms per head by 1946. Major reason for that was that the colonial rulers were not interested in whether the Indian population had enough to eat. It was mainly interested in using our land to produce the crops that it needed. So there was a diversion of land resources, as well as whatever irrigation and other resources were put in, were primarily for export. Now that particular decline of nutritional standards that you had in the 50 years before independence was sought to be reversed in the Nehruvian period. Even though the entire decline could not be reversed, by the early 90s, we had reached a position where our per capita output, even though it was not 200 kilograms per head, it was at least back to around 185 kilograms per head or so. we still had some way to go even to recapture the level of 1900. But all this came to an end with the new economic policies, because the new economic policies were essentially the reverse of the Nehruvian dirigiste policies. The new economic policies entailed once more opening up the Indian economy to global trade. And that is what the advanced countries want, because the advanced countries have a problem. They cannot produce a lot of the crops that their population has got habituated to consuming. The lands are too cold. They can grow only one crop a year. Not only can they not produce the tropical crops at all, over most of Northern Europe and North America, you can't produce tea and coffee or sugarcane. You cannot even produce cotton. Their populations have got habituated to a consumption basket which has been transformed through colonial access to our lands. And that position is something they wanted to restore. So there was intense pressure for removing all protection to our farmers, for removing all restrictions on trade, and to open up the Indian economy as far as agriculture is concerned so that it would again start producing export crops. But combined with that, if only that had happened, it would not have been so bad, perhaps. But combined with that is the other element of new economic policies, which is the dogma that governments should cut back on public spending. And cut back on public spending even if unemployment is high. Now, this has to do with a very old and long debate in economics. It was the dominant idea, which represented the view of finance capital, which is always looking to target, as it, the term is inflation targeting. Finance capital is mortally scared of inflation, so are we all. But there are various ways of overcoming inflationary tendencies in an economy. One way is to increase output and to ensure that, you know, the producers are supported adequately so that they can increase output. If your supply is increasing faster than demand, then there should not be inflation. But the emphasis that finance capitalists have always put is not on increasing output. They're not concerned with output at all. They have always put the emphasis on inflation targeting through reducing the level of activity in the economy. And this is the problem. Even when the level of employment is very high, governments are advised that the right policy is to cut back on public spending. Now, this is not an economics audience, so I don't want to get into the technical details of why this particular view is wrong, except to say that the entire theory underlying the idea of cutting the fiscal deficit being mandatory is fallacious. There is no theoretical basis to it at all. The theory was overturned more than 80 years ago by the Keynesian Revolution, but it has come back in full force in the last 30 years. And to this day, day in and day out, through the newspapers, through the television channels, you are being bombarded with the idea that the important thing in India is to cut the fiscal deficit, to cut government spending, okay? Even though unemployment rates are very high. So this is the dogma of cutting government spending and the dogma of free trade. Is this working? Can you hear me? Yeah, okay. These are the two twin dogmas which have really played havoc with our agriculture. In fact, also with manufacturing production, as a matter of fact, but here I'm concentrating on agriculture, because you can see what is happening here. This is the annual growth, decadal growth rate of central government development and total expenditure. The first two columns are the 1970s decade, second two columns, 1980s, and the third one is the 1990s when the economic reforms start. You can see that development expenditure was growing at an annual rate of approaching 7% per annum in both decades. Total expenditure, in fact, increased during the 1980s. And then what happens in the 1990s when the new economic policies come in is that there is a complete collapse of the growth rate, and this is deliberate. Growth rates of public spending is deliberately cut through fiscal contraction. And, of course, this is the central government, but the whole idea was sort of passed on to the states as well. This is the growth rate of spending on economic and social services by the different states of India. And you can see that economic services, which are the important thing, were growing at more than 10% per annum in the 1970s. It had already come down considerably by the 1980s. But in the 1990s, it disappears, that blue column. It becomes zero. In fact, in some years, it became negative. There was absolute decline. So fiscal contraction on a massive scale. And when you have this kind of fiscal contraction in agriculture, public expenditure is very important because there are certain kinds of spending which private agents simply cannot undertake. The spending on irrigation, for example. I mean, the richest Punjab farmer cannot possibly build a dam over a river, okay? So public spending is very important, and it has crowding in effects as far as private investment is concerned. If the government builds a dam, then the, you know, through seepage, the water levels surrounding the command area rises, it becomes profitable for individual farmers to sink wells and so on. All this has been well established in research work for decades on end. So when the government cuts back, what is hit is irrigation, what is hit is other kinds of rural development expenditures. What is also hit is extension services. There was a sort of withdrawal of extension services to farmers, which means knowledge about correct crop practices, crop growing practices, correct fertilizer application, seed application, the time to sow seeds and things like that, which used to be provided by through the government extension services. Now the private players moved in and they have a vested interest. I mean, people who are themselves selling seeds will tell the farmer that these are the seeds which we sell, which you should grow. Those who are selling pesticides and fertilizers will give advice to the farmer, which will maximize fertilizer and pesticide use, regardless of whether it is rational for them to use it in such high densities or not. And Andhra Pradesh has been one state where, I think most of you are aware, the pesticide use has been one of the highest, in fact, the highest in India. And all to no avail, actually. It has not increased the rate of growth of agricultural output. So as a, this is, again, the same thing. As a result of this kind of fiscal contraction, the unemployment rate in rural areas has gone up sharply. There's a kind of zigzag pattern. There's a very sharp rise in unemployment between 93-4 and 99-2000. Then there's a bit of improvement from 99-2000 to 2004, and that is mainly because there was a very severe drought in 2002-03, and the state went back to expansionary fiscal stance during that period. But then again, the latest round of the NSS data on employment show that there has been a really truly disastrous decline in employment, the growth rate of employment. I've only shown the data for 93-4 and 2004-05 here, weekly status unemployment and daily status. This is for female workers, and the same thing for male. Both go up quite sharply over this period. I haven't put down the data in a chart regarding the rate of growth of employment, but I can just give it to you. I've made a note of it somewhere. Yes, between 99-2000 to 2004-05, the overall growth rate of employment in the economy, taking rural and urban areas, was 2.7% per annum. Not bad at all. Between 2004-05 and 2009-10 is the latest year for which we have the data, the 66th round of the NSS, the urban growth rate has declined from 4% in the earlier period to 1.9%, that it has halved. The rural growth rate, which was 2.2% in the earlier five-year period, has gone down to 0.4%. This is a real collapse. And within that, female employment has registered an absolute decline. So for the economy as a whole, the growth rate of employment in the last 5 years, ending in 2009-10, has been less than 1%, 0.88% per annum, to be precise, which is much lower than the growth rate of the workforce, which means that unemployment is rising. Now, in our country, unemployment is not like in the advanced industrial countries. It is not open unemployment with people sitting around doing nothing all year. People have to survive somehow. So they try to find jobs in all kinds of, make a living in all kinds of ways. The so-called informal sector expands, which means that you're taking up small, low-paid jobs to make ends meet. So it takes mainly the form of underemployment. Now, this is the origin of the agrarian crisis. Now, the question is, why does it persist? Now, obviously, the origins of the, well, not the crisis, the depression. I'll come to the crisis in a moment. if the origins lie in fiscal contraction, has that policy changed in recent years? Not at all. On the contrary, it has made no difference which government is in power, whether it's the NDA government or whether it's the UPA government. They all subscribe to the same dogmas. So there was such acute agrarian distress during 2002-03. Thanks to rising unemployment, there was loss of purchasing power. A process of what I have been calling demand deflation, income deflation, or demand deflation, more or less synonymous. That is, if people are more and more unemployed and their purchasing power is going down, that is a situation of contraction of aggregate demand, which one can say is demand deflation. And as a consequence, what happens is that they are unable to purchase basic necessities in the amounts that they need. And this is reflected in the data on consumption of basic necessities. That is, the per capita consumption of food grains has been going down. The per capita consumption of cloth has been going down. Okay? And this cloth includes all cloth, not just cotton cloth, but if you include synthetics and everything else. The per capita consumption had gone down up to 2005. One of the things that happened, which is very similar to what is happening now, in the 3 years running up to 2002-03 drought, you had a massive buildup of public food grain stocks. By June, July of 2002, if I remember correctly, public stocks were in the neighborhood of 64 million tons. I wrote extensively about this in an article called Food Stocks and Hunger, Causes of Agrarian Distress. Now, these 64 million tons were like 40 million tons in excess of what the norms of that time were. The government should have been holding about 24 million tons. Instead, it had this mountain of food grain stocks of 64 million tons. How was this being interpreted? Even by very famous economists and leading economists, whose names I won't take now, they interpreted it as overproduction. They said that giving high prices to the Punjab and Haryana farmers is leading them to produce more than is required. Completely wrong. It was not overproduction which was leading to buildup of stocks. It was underconsumption, right? It was the loss of purchasing power, which is also reflected in the downward movement of food consumption and cloth consumption that emerged from the NSS data. But as a result of this wrong analysis, what the government then did was twofold. The NDA government, instead of trying to distribute food stocks to the hungry, to the increasingly hungry, exported 22 million tons of food grains over the 2 years, 2002 and 2003, the worst drought year we have had for a very long time. And who did it export to? It exported to advanced countries. The importing countries used Indian grain to feed their cattle and their pigs. It was used as livestock feed. So while our own population went hungry, you know, foreign cattle got fatter, if I want to, you know, put it in a nutshell. So can you imagine anything more irrational than this? And as a result of the wrong analysis of thinking of it as overproduction, the government then froze procurement prices from farmers for 5 years. There was no rise virtually in procurement prices, even though cost of inputs was going up, cost of production was going up sharply. So what was the result? Our food grains output stagnated for 4 years, 5 years, at around 212, 215 million tons. No increase at all. Even Punjab and Haryana, the grain bowl of our country, around 26, 28 million tons was the maximum of wheat which was being produced for these 5 years, because farmers were not covering their costs with this kind of policy. It was only the global food price rise from 2008. There was a very sharp spike in global food prices, and there were riots in cities in 37 countries. It was only then that the government woke up. By then, it was the UPA one government, and it suddenly raised the procurement price very substantially. It had been trying to run down our public distribution system before that. It then started to revive the PDS, procuring more and so on. And farmers also responded immediately. After a moderate drought in 2009-10, by 2011-12, our output, food grains output, peaked at more than 250 million tons. But then we have the same scenario today that we had then. That is, purchasing power has gone down so much that stocks are building up. I have recently written a short piece where I'm drawing a parallel between what was happening in 2003 and what is happening today, 10 years later, in 2013. There's a very eerie kind of similarity between the two. And the reason is the same in both cases. I've shown you the figures for fiscal contraction and rising unemployment earlier. I've given you the figures for rising unemployment in the more recent period. Has there been fiscal contraction in the more recent period? Yes. The moment the UPA government came to power in 2004, and you know, everybody was very euphoric because there had been so much agrarian distress. The NDA had put forward this India Shining slogan, saying that India is shining, even the poor are shining, which was patently untrue. And I think the Congress itself did not expect to win because it was partly convinced by the slogans, so it was very surprised when it won. But I know for a fact that that the leading congressmen were quite surprised when they defeated the NDA. But then it was, of course, it needed support from the left, from outside, which the left then gave because it was Congress was a much more progressive force than the NDA was, with this persecution of, you know, with at least some adherence of the coalition persecuting minorities and so on. But one of the first things the UPA government did, which was very ominous, but which was not criticized sufficiently at that time, I kept writing about it, but I'm not taken seriously as a macroeconomist, unfortunately, so nobody paid any attention to my writing about it. One of the first things it did was to notify the FRBM Act, the Fiscal Responsibility and Budgetary Management Act, which makes it legally mandatory for the government to reduce the fiscal deficit, to cut back on public spending. Okay? In fact, to do precisely what had led to the crisis, which led to the ouster of the NDA government in the first place. And the target set was by 2007, the fiscal deficit to GDP ratio had to be brought down to 2.8%. Now, in the budget speech that the finance minister, Mr. Chidambaram, gave, I remember his claiming very proudly in early 2007 in his budget speech that the target had been more than met. The previous year's deficit ratio was only 2.7%, whereas the target was 2.8%. So there was severe fiscal contraction put in place immediately in the first 3 years of the UPA government itself. And this fiscal contraction could not have been timed more badly, because actually it reminds me of what the Japanese finance minister, Mr. K. Inoue — Inoue was the name of the Japanese finance minister in 1928. And some of my previous students who are sitting here will remember my lectures on Japan. What did he do in 1928? He introduced deflationary policies in Japan on the very eve of the global financial and economic crisis, the Great Depression, which started from the end of 1928, early 1929, with the New York stock market collapse. Because he simply could not, had no idea that the capitalist world was going to go into depression. So as a result, the Japanese farmers' exports collapsed. Same thing was done by Mr. Chidambaram. Now, Mr. Inoue, later on, he was attacked so much for following deflationary policies on top of the collapse of American demand for Japanese farmers' exports. He wrote a book trying to justify himself called The Problem of the Japanese Exchange. I don't know whether Mr. Chidambaram is going to write a book after he retires from public life. I don't think so, because nobody has criticized him on these grounds. But he did exactly what Inoue had done. He deflated the Indian economy. He introduced severe fiscal compression on the very eve of financial crisis an economic crisis in the advanced capitalist world on the eve of a collapse of demand for Indian exports. So the Indian farmer was faced with a double blow. The blow of contracting public expenditures, of development expenditures, and the blow of reducing exports together. So is it very surprising that you find that between 2005 and 2009-10, you have such bad employment figures? The employment growth practically collapses. And of course, the global recession plus the deflationary policies affected not only agriculture, but also the manufacturing sector, particularly small producers. I must tell you here, some of you are thinking that I'm supposed to be talking about agrarian distress. Why am I talking so much about much broader level policies, of macroeconomic policies? This is because I believe what Paul Baran, the famous Marxist economist, said is very true. Paul Baran said in one of his books that what is cooked in the kitchen is not decided in the kitchen. Decided outside. So similarly, what happens in our agriculture is more and more not decided because of internal developments within our agriculture. It is decided more and more by external factors to agriculture, which includes the government's own economic policies towards agriculture, which have included fiscal contraction, which I've been talking about so far, as well as the whole question of what is happening globally in terms of global demand for Indian agricultural products. This brings me to the second element of agrarian distress and indeed crisis, which has not been reversed, which is continuing, and which is, and therefore the agrarian problem is continuing, and that is free trade, opening up the Indian agriculture to unrestricted import, more and more unrestricted import and export. Now, the earlier policies did not say that we should not export. As a matter of fact, the rate of growth of our exports was higher in the period of controls than it was in the 1990s. What it said was that particularly from agriculture, we should export raw materials only after making sure that the needs of our domestic industry is met. Okay? Raw cotton, for example. Now, raw cotton and cotton yarn are the most important raw material for the most important manufacturing sector in this country, the textile industry. And the textile industry is highly differentiated. You have handloom weavers, you have small-scale power loom enterprises, you have large-scale factories. But most of the employment comes from the small-scale enterprises in the textile sector. So what happened in, from the late 1980s, that there was a completely mindless opening up to unrestricted export of raw materials. And again, nobody was paying much attention to the effects of this. I remember vaguely some figures, let me try and recollect them. That is, just in a period of 2 years, I think 1989 to 91, India's raw cotton exports were allowed to go from 34,000 tons to 374,000 tons, more than tenfold increase. Why? Because that was the new mantra. Cotton prices were rising globally. The Commerce Ministry said, we are removing restrictions. Export, make money. And at that time, the World Bank economists and others from northern universities were saying that these restrictions on exports are harming the Indian farmer. Indian farmers should be able to access global prices. A lot of our very sensible political leaders like Mr. VP Singh also fell for it and said that why should Indian farmers not access global prices? Why should there be restrictions? What they were not told is that now prices are rising. 4 years later, 5 years later, prices will decline. And what will you do if you open up your economy then, if you remove protection to the farmer? No, nobody listened at that time. I wrote a paper, but as I've said, you know, nobody paid any attention, as far as I'm aware, to the negative things I was saying about this kind of unreasoning opening up. Actually, the first suicides that took place were not of cotton farmers in Andhra or in Vidarbha. The first suicides on a large scale were of handloom weavers in Karnataka particularly, and probably also in Andhra, and the closure of hundreds and hundreds of power loom units. Why? Because when you allow this kind of mindless export in the name of free trade, what happened was that within a period of 2 to 3 years, the price of raw cotton, the price of yarn trebled. You know, the index of 100, it went up to 300. Now, since the domestic demand is not expanding, in fact, it is actually being restrained through these kind of fiscal contractionary policies which had been put in place, what is the handloom, how is the handloom weaver going to sell his output? Are the small power loom units going to sell their output when the raw material cost has trebled? So there were dozens of handloom weavers' families who committed suicide. There was no publicity given to it, or very little at that time. People were so completely euphoric. We had the new economic policy, and they all fell for the false promises which were being made that India was going to gain in terms of billions of dollars through free trade. And when I wrote negatively about this, people said, okay, it's a bad impact on handloom weavers, but at least the cotton farmers are benefiting because they have high prices. In fact, you had a huge expansion of cotton producing area in the Telangana region, in Vidarbha region, in Gujarat, in Punjab, everywhere, because cotton prices were high globally. And a lot of people got into the act who had never grown cotton before. Because the prices were high, they were allowed to export. Cotton needs much more money than jawar or bajra, which they were growing earlier, so they had to borrow. And they got less money from the banks because the financial sector reforms meant they were no longer being given the same treatment as earlier. So they had to go to the money lenders. Nobody told them that now prices are rising, 4 years later they will crash. And they did indeed start crashing from 1995 onwards. Between 1995 and 2001, cotton prices halved. So all these people who had borrowed money thinking the bonanza was going to continue, after 2 years they found they could not repay. So from 97-98, small farmers' capacity for holding on is only about 2 or 3 years, not more than that. From 97-98, you get the farmer suicides because of indebtedness. So what opening up to free trade does is to expose farmers to global price volatility. This is the problem. The price volatility struck the Kerala farmers a bit later. Let me go to the price, some of the chart showing you what was happening to coconut prices. Let me go to pepper prices first. See, whereas the cotton prices started crashing from the mid-1990s, they go up and down. Then again, they've been rising of late. In the case of the coffee, tea, pepper, and so on, the price rise continued up to the end of the 90s, and then you get the crash. And I don't know whether you can see the graph here. That purple line is the Indian domestic price, which is practically the same as the international price. And the competitors by now are Vietnam and Indonesia, because India has signed a free trade agreement with Sri Lanka. And Sri Lanka was being used as a door through which the Vietnamese producers were pouring in their products into southern India as well. So that's why the comparison is given here. But they were regulating their internal prices much better than our government was regulating our prices. You can see the purple line from $5,000 US dollars per ton. Within a matter of 2 years, the crash is to less than $2,000 per ton in the case of pepper. Okay? And then there's a further decline, but at a much slower rate after that. Now, you know, if you are a manufacturing producer, if you are producing cement or shoes or whatever it is, and you've invested money in setting up a plant because price is high, and you've just started producing and your output is coming out and then the price crashes to 1/3 or 40% of what it was earlier, you're not going to be able to recover your cost. You're not going to be able to repay to the banks. So no producer in manufacturing can survive this kind of a price crash. And of course, our producers in agriculture, the peasant producers, are small. The majority of them are small producers. Their holding capacity is much, much less. That is why, and there is another thing I should mention which is important, which is that if I'm a manufacturing producer, I'm not a farmer, but I produce shoes or cement or whatever, then if I've put in my raw materials, I've paid for my electricity and my fuel, my labor, I have a pretty good idea of what my output is going to be because the coefficients are fixed. I know what my output will be. But if I'm a farmer, even after I put in my irrigation water, my seed, my fertilizers, my pesticides, I'm not quite sure what my output is going to be. It'll vary within a range. It's not within my control. Okay? So agriculture is different from manufacturing in this respect, that producers face price output uncertainty. We must always remember this, which is why for them, some degree of price certainty is very important. Without that, you can't make any informed decisions about how much you're going to plant, what you're going to plant. And if you add price uncertainty to output uncertainty, then it means you're finished. Now, this price uncertainty, was it not there earlier? No. Because after independence, precisely because of the suffering of small producers in agriculture, owing to price uncertainty, a number of price stabilization measures had been put in place by government. And one of them you all know about, that is the setting up of the Food Corporation of India, which basically undertakes to purchase from food grains to an unlimited extent. If I'm a farmer, I'm given the assurance that I can sell as much as I want to. And the FCI or its agents will purchase it at a fixed price, which is announced in advance. That price may be lower than the global price today. If I export, I might be getting a higher price. But if the global price crashes, the FCI price does not crash. It's not allowed to crash. That is the way it operated from 1965 onwards. You know, for 30 years, it operated pretty well. And somehow, our Haryana and Punjab farmers, who are much reviled by the leftists and Marxists by as being kulaks and so on, somehow they were not interested in maximizing when global prices were high. They didn't rush to export. They were quite happy to sell to the Food Corporation of India, even when the domestic price was lower than the global price, because for them, the price certainty was very important. And if the government enters in a big way as a purchaser, then the private traders cannot allow their price to fall below the minimum support price of the government because there's an alternative for the farmer. The farmer will not sell to the private trader, he will go to the government. So that price stabilization measure was important, but it was not only food grains. You had the commodity boards. You had the spices board, the tea board, the coffee board, Cotton Corporation of India, and so on. All these were mandated to purchase from the farmer at minimum support prices. And this purchase function was very important in stabilizing prices. They purchased variable amounts. Sometimes only 25% could go up to 35-40% in some years, depending on what the global price was. If the global price was tending to fall, more farmers would sell at the assured domestic price, right? But the purchase function, through a central government notification or decree or whatever, all these boards were told, give up the purchase function completely. Now your job is simply to monitor what is happening to global prices and internal prices. No purchase from the farmers. So at one stroke, price stabilization was removed. And the farmers were exposed to this kind of volatility. Whichever crop you take, whether you take cotton, whether you take coconut, some of these are more to do with Kerala, because I spent some time in Kerala looking at the problem of farmers' suicides in Wayanad, Palghat, and so on. This is the price trend of coconut. Again, you can see that the rivals, Indonesia and Philippines, managed their price fluctuations much better than India did. India's is that one. 1991, the price was more than $200 per ton. And then by the 1995, it has fallen to something like $80 per ton. Very large fall. And subsequently, it has gone up, but then fallen again. So the trend is downward. The last price for 2004 or 5 is about $60 per ton. Okay. Now, this order of price volatility is something farmers simply cannot take. Now, as a result, I've been looking at what the agrarian distress has meant in terms of loss of land. Uh, But these, I think I've revised these figures. The final figures in 2003 are higher than what you see here, but it doesn't really matter. The trend is clear enough. The trend is that every group, if I construct the Lorentz curves of concentration, this is for Kerala, but I've got the Lorentz curves for all India as well. Yes, owned area with households in 2003 compared with 1992. The next data set of data on owned area in rural households is going to be for 2013. We don't have it yet. Should be available by next year. So if I construct the Lorentz curves and I read off what is the percentage, look at the right-hand side mainly, you can have different divisions. The division I've chosen is the lowest 65%, middle 25%, and top 10, and the top 10 is divided into the topmost 5% and the next 5%. You have to take the same percentiles in order to compare in the different years. Okay? And you find that every group has lost land. And the only group which has gained is the top 5% in rural India. In fact, they have gained more land from the next 5% below them than they have from the others, the really poor landowners, because in any case, the really poor people have very little land to sell, even in distress. So what has happened is what we would expect, that a situation of agrarian distress and crisis, which results in rising indebtedness, very often leads, this is a very typical scenario, that indebted farmers first sell whatever durable commodities they might, goods they might have, their pots and pans and so on. And when that has gone, they start selling bits of their land in order to be able to pay debt. And we would expect the last time you had land concentration increasing, land ownership concentration increasing, was during the period of the Great Depression of the 1920s, exactly the same scenario, where land concentration increased. Yeah, in Kerala, of course, the land concentration has gone up enormously as well. You know, the top 5% had 38% of owned area in 1992. By 2003, it had 46.5% of total owned area, almost half the total owned area in the state. So these figures were not at all popular with those who like to think that Kerala has a very equitable land distribution. It doesn't. The need for land reform continues in Kerala. Land reforms are by no means over. And if you do a study for Andhra Pradesh, I have no doubt at all that you'll find exactly the same situation. Okay, this I don't have to linger. This is the farmer and general suicide rates, mainly from Professor Nagaraj's figures. He has done this study at the Madras Institute of Development Studies. Now, I just want to show you the food grains availability figures here. This is the pre-reform trend, 1978 to 1990. This is the post-reform trend, 1990 to 2008. Now, these are three-year averages, actually, because with food grains, you know, there's fluctuation. So single years don't give a good idea. So when I say 1990 to 2008, it's actually the average of 1989-1991, the initial period, terminal period average of 2007-8-9. You can see it's exactly the reverse. This is what has happened to food grains availability. It has come down to an all-time low. Now, just a word about food grains availability. How do we calculate availability? It is quite simple. You basically subtract from output net exports, and you subtract from output net addition to public stocks to get availability. The more exports there are, and the more addition to public stocks there are, the less will be the availability. Okay? And why should there be addition to public stocks and exports? In the year 2007, after this contractionary efforts of Mr. Chidambaram had increased unemployment and reduced purchasing power, India reached, up to that point, the lowest level of per capita food grains availability for all purposes in the entire world, lower than the level for least developed countries, much lower than the level for sub-Saharan Africa. It did not have the lowest level of per capita output. But the point is that people were, owing to loss of purchasing power, And owing to targeting in the public distribution system, the artificial divide between the below poverty line and above poverty line, which the government introduced from 1997. Number one, they had lost purchasing power and therefore they could not purchase as much as they wanted. And number two, those who were poor, actually poor and entitled to subsidized food grains, were being told that they were not poor, that they belonged to the above poverty line category by the government. So they were simply priced out from the public distribution system. They could not afford the APL prices. So this is a shocking state of affairs. And right now, in 2007, India added, India exported 17 million tons of food grains. It added 14 million tons to public stocks. So out from output, you had to deduct 17 plus 14, which is 31 million tons to get the availability, simply because of loss of purchasing power. Now, in the last 3 years, again, huge stocks have been building up. By June, July of last year, public food grain stocks had reached some over 80 million tons, when the buffer norms are around 26 million. So more than 55 million tons of excess food stocks, just as had happened in 2002, 2003, right? In January of this year, you see, there is quarterly variation in the stocks. Because obviously when the harvest comes in and there is procurement, the stocks go up. That is to be expected. But then there should be offtake and the stocks should be going down. The January buffer norm is around a little less than 22 million tons. But in January, we had 65 million tons of stocks. Again, more than 40 million tons of excess food stocks. After procurement from the current Rabi harvest, procurement started in March, okay, and is probably still going on, the stocks have ballooned further. And once again, instead of taking the decision to distribute these food grains to a population which is increasingly underfed, the government is allowing exports. Already this year, 15 million tons have been exported. It is being predicted by this year, I mean the agricultural year, the 9 months ending in, or rather the financial year, the 9 months ending in December 2012. 15 million, more than 15 million tons have been exported. It is expected over the entire year, it'll cross more than 20 million tons. If that happens, this will be the largest ever exports that India has made of food grains. And in a situation where domestic hunger is growing, where the availability of food grains is going down, where consumption is going down. As a matter of fact, I'll just give you briefly some figures before winding up. The average calorie intake in rural India, which was 2,221 in 1983, by 2009-10, is down to 2020. Protein intake is down from 62 grams to 55 grams. In urban India, the calorie intake is down from 2089 in 1983 to 1946 in 2009-10. Protein intake was stable right up to 2005. In the last 5 years ending in 9-10, it has gone down from 57 grams to 53.5 grams because urban India too is being impacted by the high rate of food price inflation. I have no time to discuss the poverty issue or give you some poverty figures, but if there is a question on that and discussion on that, I can do that because as Professor Vamsi pointed out, I have been undertaking a very intensive critique of the official poverty lines and poverty estimates, which is now almost a decade old. And I have also analyzed the latest data, consumption data, to estimate poverty directly from the 66th round 2009-10. And he has already summarized very nicely the findings that in the entire pre-reform period, the proportion of people in poverty using the Planning Commission's original definition, which was nutrition-based, that is the proportion of people who, through their monthly spending, total monthly spending on all goods and services, the food spending part, allowed them to access 2,200 calories per day in rural India. That proportion was fluctuating around 57% or so, right up to the reform period. But Subsequently, it has completely shot up. It has shot up from around 57 to 75% by 2009-10 in rural India. And in urban India, again, it was fluctuating around 56-57% earlier. Small ups and downs, no large trend. In the post-reform period, in urban India, it has gone up by 2009-10 to 73% of persons who are not able to access the lower urban intake, which is 2,100 calories per day through their monthly spending. Now, obviously, you and I don't belong to that category. Our intake is not going down. So this is the average. So it means that if it's going down on average, it's going down much more than the average for those for whom it is going down. So it is not just a question of agrarian distress, but I think the distress is now getting spilling over also to urban areas, and that is natural because there is migration always from rural areas to urban areas of people in search of work when they don't get enough work, when they can't make a living in the rural areas. So now, actually, in the last 5 years ending in 2009-10, we find a faster rise in urban poverty, directly measured, than even in rural poverty, whereas rural poverty was, of course, has worsened, but urban poverty has worsened faster in the more recent period, which is a very, very interesting finding, and which is what explains at last the signs of some signs of urban discontent emerging, because so far the urban population had it reasonably good. It was the rural population which was bearing the brunt of the neoliberal policies, but that sector is no longer insulated. Thank you very much. I think I've taken a lot of your time. Thank you very much.